ートビデオ。
Once upon a time in the late 1970s, there was a science fiction writer from Japan named Haruka Takachiho. He had emerged at the right time for a sci-fi writer because the late 70s was the time where science fiction, specifically space operas, were beginning to gain popularity in Japan. This was thanks to the works by Leiji Matsumoto and a small foreign indie film by the name of Star Wars. Takachiho was already making a name for himself with both his Crusher Joe series and the animation studio he had helped found, Studio Nue. It is these two claims to fame that led him to a fateful encounter with British sci-fi writer A. Bertram Chandler. Sometime in 1978, Chandler had visited Studio Nue one day, and after the tour, Takachiho decided to entertain him by taking him to a World Women's Wrestling Association match. Accompanying him were two female staffers, Keiko Otogura and Yuri Tanaka. During a match that featured the popular tag team Beauty Pair, an unspecified event took place involving the two staffers that caused Chandler to remark to Takachiho, "Those two up there may be the Beauty Pair, but the two with you ought to be called the Dirty Pair." We don't know exactly what prompted this rude response, but we do know it gave Takachiho an idea for his next novel series. He had been toying around with an idea for a hard-boiled detective story with a hard sci-fi setting, not unlike the old American pulps he used to read as a kid. And now he had potential protagonists to fully realize that idea. His editor, on the other hand, wasn't too keen on it. While stories with a singular female protagonist could conceivably sell in Japan, stories with two female protagonists was an entirely different beast. Takachiho needed a hook, and after much deliberation, he found one. His solution was to give the two protagonists strongly contrasting personalities. One, the ideal Japanese woman, calm, polite, and feminine, at least on the outside. The other, a brash tomboy, hot-blooded, loud, and with a hair-trigger temper. Together, these two clashing personalities work for the World Welfare Works Association, or 3WA, as trouble consultants, helping various people solve planetary-scale problems for profit. Making their debut in issue number 244 of SF Magazine in 1979, Kei and Yuri, named after the two women that inspired them, enthralled readers with their exploits as the Lovely Angels. But thanks to their tendency towards collateral damages, the two were more commonly known as the Dirty Pair. The first novel, The Dirty Pair's Great Adventure, was an instant hit among critics and audiences alike. Winning a Seiyun Award and gaining enough popular traction to warrant a well-received cameo in the Crusher Joe movie, talk soon surfaced of an anime featuring the titular pair. So, Studio Nue, in conjunction with Sunrise, produced a 26-episode series starring the Lovely Angels, with the simple title of Dirty Pair. Honestly, where do I even begin with Dirty Pair? Even if you've never seen it, you are at least familiar with the look of it. Along with Lum and Ryo Saiba, Kei and Yuri are some of the most recognizable protagonists of 80s anime. And that could be attributed to the fact that Dirty Pair is an anime series that is forever attached to the roots of anime fandom in the United States. The series is one of the first animes imported and fansubbed to be passed around at conventions and anime clubs. The movie and OVA of Dirty Pair were some of Streamline's first localization projects. Some of the first anime cosplays are related to Dirty Pair. The first anime fanfiction to be posted on Usenet in 1991 was a Dirty Pair fanfic. In the mid to late 90s, Dark Horse Comics created a best-selling American comic book adaptation of Dirty Pair in an art style that has definitely not stood the test of time. And even today, Dirty Pair is still a prime source of fan art, cosplay, aesthetic gifts, and future funk compilations. And all of this from an anime that only lasted 24 of its ordered 26 episodes. Yes, Nippon TV, the network that aired the show, regarded Dirty Pair as a ratings failure and canceled it before it even completed its 26-episode run, ultimately releasing the unaired episode in an OVA compilation. Which is strange considering that, by all means, it was successful amongst sci-fi fans and otaku in its home country. Kei and Yuri even made it into the top 5 of Animage's best leading ladies that year, Yuri even beating out Lum. From what is known, Nippon TV wanted the show to appeal to general audiences rather than the fandom niche Takachiho had built up over the years. And since they didn't get that, early cancellation it was. But anyway, I've talked enough about the history of Dirty Pair enough. What of the actual anime itself? First off, they changed a lot from the original novels. The original novels had a raygun gothic setting to reflect the types of sci-fi stories Takachiho himself had grown up on. The Dirty Pair anime, on the other hand, had an aesthetic of a 1980s sci-fi setting. There was also the matter of tone. While the novels did try to keep things lighthearted, they still weren't afraid to not shy away from dark and serious subject matter. The anime, by contrast, dialed up the lightheartedness noticeably. Serious subject matter was still present, though the tone was kept light throughout, most episodes usually ending with the angels either bickering, in trouble with the chief, or sharing a good hearty laugh. More drastic changes are the things they added and removed from the stories. One big thing from the novels that the anime removed, or at the very least didn't hint at, is that Kay and Yuri share a psychic link of clairvoyance together. This psychic link not only allows them to solve mysteries, but also gives them an insane amount of luck that allows them to escape the disasters that seem to follow them unscathed. In fact, it even is implied that their latent psychic powers are the reason trouble just seems to find them. The anime just chalks all this up to the angels' willingness to solve the case regardless of the cost, or just bad luck in general. What the anime does add are sidekicks. Two of them, in fact. One, the gigantic genetically modified house cat Mugi, and the other, the diminutive robot Nanmo. And they actually get a lot more mileage than just being merely annoying mascot characters. Mugi serves not only as a comical pet, but also the angel's mount, pack mule, and makeshift blanket. Nanmo, meanwhile, kinda sort of serves as the angel's R2-D2, there to pilot shifts, hack into systems, or otherwise get the angels out of any and all technological jams. But this anime is not about them. What of the titular duo? Well, very little change of the angel's personality and transfer between book to screen. Kay is still abrasive, tomboyish, and itching for a scrap. And it's all the more amplified when the voice of Kay, Kyoko Togo, can effectively sound angry. On the flip side, Yuri is still prim, ladylike, and civil, sometimes playing the straight girl to Kay's antics. But the anime is still not afraid to show off her darker, occasionally more mischievous side, particularly when you have Seiko Shimazu perfectly willing to play up Yuri's coyness in her performance. But the true strength of Kay and Yuri as characters lies in their strength as a team. They are not overpowered by any means. When caught in a jam, they not only have to make use of their weapon or martial powers, but their wits and teamwork. A lot of conflict of the series usually evolves around either solving a mystery or facing off against a foe they must figure out how to beat. And those problems are usually solved by both of them putting their heads together and formulating a plan. Together, they are some of the most capable female protagonists in anime, even if they do occasionally exhibit some annoying female stereotypes. And while they may bicker, that aspect of their relationship is shown to never be a hindrance to their operations. They are always helping each other, looking out for each other, rescuing each other, just doing anything that proves that they would be weaker working alone than they would be working together. And they just don't work together because they're trying to get a paycheck. No, the anime really showcases how much they truly care for one another. But let's put a pin in that for now. We'll go into more detail as we talk about the show as a whole. Where Dirty Pair is strongest is in how it animates its action scenes. For a television series, the action scenes in Dirty Pair are some of the strongest that's come from this era. Even though they do some cost-saving measures that were common at the time, the action is some of the most fluid you can see for a television series, especially the way Kay and Yuri move. Nearly everything the angels do appears to be a natural reaction to the situation at hand. The animators really want to give you the impression that the angels are constantly on their toes when fighting off bad guys. Kay and Yuri are using every tool at their disposal, whether they be guns, gadgets, whatever's just lying around, their own two fists, or this.
Busto de katteru. なんたって男はバストに惹かれるの。
And the way the action scenes are paced are also worthy of praise. In between the punches, Kay and Yuri are constantly communicating with each other, explaining plans, offering suggestions, yelling out warnings, and of course the occasional verbal barbs and quips. It helps give scenes a sense of rhythm that allows the tension to build up to an impressive climax that usually involves a building collapsing, or a starship exploding, or an entire planet being blown to Kingdom Come. But it's not just the action that's given preferential treatment. There's also the way the setting is presented. For a television anime, the animators put a lot of detail into bringing the setting of Dirty Pair to life, in a way that they more than likely didn't intend. Back when I said the staff opted for a more 1980s visual style for the setting, they obviously meant to modernize the setting since this was a 1985 anime. So the result is a universe where it is centuries in the future where we have mastered space travel, and yet we still use phones with cords and take Skype calls via CRT TV screens. And while some can and will complain that this level of technology dates the anime, I feel this adds another layer to what makes Dirty Pair appealing. Utilizing then-current technology to help build a universe that can appear both sleek and new as well as lived in really helps build an entirely unique setting that only gets better as it ages. The staff unintentionally helped give the world of Dirty Pair a sense of identity outside of its source material. The anime became a thrilling cassette futurist tale thanks to the march of technology. Now, you may have noticed for all the praise I've heaped on this anime, I haven't really talked about the story of Dirty Pair just yet. And there is a reason for that. In the pre-production stage of Dirty Pair, the staff had a problem. Going over the written material for Dirty Pair, they only had one book to adapt at the time, and they didn't feel like there was enough of that to turn into a full series. For whatever reason, they also couldn't adapt any of the stories that were currently being serialized in SF Magazine. So the solution was to just make up their own short subject stories about the angels. Thus, the anime became an episodic one. Aside from a two-parter involving disappearing passengers from a passenger ship and the conspiracy that follows, each episode is their own self-contained story. These stories involve, but are not limited to, space pirates, sewer monsters, treasure hunters, secret agents, serial killers, spaghetti westerns, mistaken identities, blues musicians, herds of cats, super intelligent rats, the Terminator, and being forced to solve the mystery of who destroyed a rich boy's real doll. Since every episode is their own self-contained story, the quality of each episode does tend to vary. Though no episode truly feels awful, some episodes are definitely more memorable than others. But I'd actually like to talk about two episodes that stick out in particular for me, personally. The first episode we're going to talk about, Love is Everything, Betting Their Lives on Elopement, could be seen as a very simple episode at first, even if the opening does feel like the beginning to an incredibly niche fetish video. This bottom in the tux being forced into bigamy is named Clicky Goldjeff, heir to the wealthy Goldjeff fortune. But before anyone can acknowledge how unbelievably stupid that name sounds, a one-woman army by the name of Joanka busts in, ruins the wedding Arnold Schwarzenegger in commando style, and makes off with Clicky, who seems strangely happy to be with her. So naturally, the angels are called in by Mr. Goldjeff to retrieve his son and pay his kidnapper 2 million credits. Mr. Goldjeff has made his fortune on entirely revolutionary ways of space travel and tourism, his latest venture being time dilation tourism. Anyway, Mr. Goldjeff wants his son back no matter what the cost, dropping a few hints that he really doesn't like Joanka because of something that happened in her past. We cut back to Clicky and Joanka being quite the cute couple. The kidnapping was just a plot for them to elope and have a wonderful life together. While discussing their plans for the future, however, we do get some more hints of Joanka's past. Meanwhile, the angels get a call from Joanka, who has bugged their hotel room, saying where she'll be for the transaction and that they better bring the money, otherwise she can't guarantee Clicky's safety. Apparently, she is just using his oblivious love to her to get the money. When they do get to the meeting site the next day, it would appear that after handing over the cash, Joanka reveals her true colors.
You are just for the money.
But the Angels noticed something fishy and soon discovered that Joanka was being set up through a neural transmitter. Mr. Goldjeff reveals himself to be masterminding the whole scheme, from manipulating the Angels via hotel room to the neural transmitter set up by his secretary slash mistress. And this is when we get the reveal of Joanka's past.
やめてよパパ。過去の話なんかどうだっていい。今のジョアンカは立派な女性だ。いくら手術を受け体が女であっても断じてお前たちの中を許すわけにはいかん。だからどうしたっていうのよ。頭古いんじゃないの。
今や 10人 に 1人は転換手術を受けている時代なのに。
An anime from the 1980s is more progressive than Western TV today? Who'd have thunk? But it gets better. After a fight and quick chase scene, we find out that Mr. Goldjeff is going to put Joanka in one of his time dilation tours, meaning that while the trip will be one day for her, it'll be 50 years for Clicky. The lovely Angels try to stop this, but it's too late.
Joanka. Joanka.
Clicky, しっかりして.
行く. 僕も行く.
何だと?
ジョアンカを追って宇宙へ行く.
バカなことを考えるな、クリッキー。
パパは黙ってて! 僕は行く。 50年後の世界で一緒になるんだ。
偉い! そんな無茶な! ユリは黙ってなさい。 でもね! クリッキー、 あんたこそ男の中の男よ。
いかん、 そんなこと絶対に許さん。
あなたは黙っててください。 許す許さないの問題じゃないんです。
その通り。
やっぱりまずいわ。
あんたも女らしくないね。 私たちは二人の味方なの。 そう決めたんだからもういいの。 最後の最後まで面倒見ちゃう。行け、クリッキー!
クリッキー!
<笑>幸せをつかんでね、クリッキー。
私は何も知らんからね。
結婚式には呼んでよね。
私たちおばあちゃんになってるわよ。
What a heartwarming and romantic ending. Too bad it's kind of mitigated by Mr. Goldjeff deciding to follow his son in the last ship, thus meaning the whole cycle could be destined to start over again. But even then, the Angels swear they're gonna solve that, even if they are old ladies by then. So not only is this episode pretty legit when it comes to romance, it also shows us that the Angels are always willing to help people. They don't just do this for the money or the glory or the chance to kick ass. They are devoted to their job because they know their responsibility is to help others in need, even if they do destroy everything in their path to do so. The next episode, Gotta Do It, Love is a Woman's Detonator, is easily the best episode of the series because it is the episode that best explores the relationship between Kay and Yuri. It starts out with Yuri getting a letter from an old childhood friend named Billy, with whom she made a romantic promise 12 years ago, and it is one Yuri intends to keep. This really rubs Kay the wrong way, not only because Yuri begins to annoy her with her gushing about Billy, but also Yuri leaving for Billy could easily spell the end of the lovely Angels.
じゃあうちらのコンビは?
新しい相棒を探せばいいのよ。 私より優秀なのはいっぱいいるわ。
そりゃいるでしょうよ! 死ぬほどいるよ! 吐いて捨てるほどね! だからどうだっつの?
However, it turns out this letter from Billy was actually a distress call from a planet known as Poisonville, where he and other engineers are currently being held prisoner in an arms manufacturing plant. Yuri wants to go rescue him, but since 3WA is a business first and foremost, their hands are tied unless someone contracts them to go rescue him. It seems that all hope is lost until...
ここから技術者を救出してほしいんだ。成功報酬は100万クレジット。それでどんなもんかね。仕事を受けするかどうかはコンピューターが判断いたしますので。
そう固いこと言うな。10万クレジット前金として支払うから、それでどうだね。
は、そういうことでしたら、それでは入金が確認され次第うちの腕利き捜査員を派遣いたします。はい。ここに直通で依頼が来るとどういうことなんだ。
So Kay and Yuri get contracted to go rescue the engineers along with Billy. After some intense jetpack gunfights, they are able to rescue all the engineers except for one. Billy is nowhere to be seen. Kay decides to go into the base and look for Billy for Yuri, even if finding him could result in the termination of their partnership. And she does end up finding him in the worst way possible.
あんたがビリーなの?
死んでからもこうしてここからユリに信号を送り続けてきたのね。
人殺しの機械を作るなんてもう僕にはできない。もうすぐ僕は殺されるだろう。ユリとの約束守れなくてごめんね。
From here, K has two options. Tell Yuri the truth and end up breaking her heart in the middle of a mission, or lying to her. She tries to save off making the decision by focusing on the fighting, giving her jetpack to the last engineer, and telling Yuri to go back to the ship alone. Yuri won't have any of that and returns with a jetpack for K, saying that she could not leave K alone. After this fight, K ultimately chooses her latter option, but does so in a way that lets Yuri down gently.
Yuri?
Huh?
私、ビリーと話したわ。ちょっとだけ。
そう。
本物のルーシアはまだまだ先になりそうだってさ。
そう。でもやっぱり会わないでよかったみたい。ビリには思い出の中で会えるもの。
それと、今でもユリのこと好きだってさ。
でしょうね。
It's kind of left up in the air whether or not Yuri knows K is lying to her to keep her spirits up, but they don't dwell on that for long as they now have to fight an entire air fleet. All while K casually offhandedly mentioned that she had to use their savings to contract this mission, making Yuri none too happy. This entire episode is the perfect case for why the Lovely Angels make such a good duo. It's not just the athletics, the smarts, the guns, the gizmos, the go-go boots, the 80s hair, the wanton acts of destruction that make the Lovely Angels. It's that despite their radical differences in personality and constant bickering, they will always come through each other. K has Yuri's back, and Yuri has K's back. In my opinion, even though it doesn't show up all that often, this episode, those facts are what give Dirty Bear a lot of heart to it. But that's really all the depth there is to it. Dirty Bear is an action anime and is really content on being an action anime. It doesn't really want to focus so much on themes as it does just want to focus on two badass girls blowing shit up. And for some people, that might not be enough. But even if the focus is on the action, and even if the angels themselves don't exactly shatter any stereotypes, you really can't deny that they may have helped lay the groundwork for future anime. After Dirty Pair, it seemed like editors and producers alike were willing to take more chances on stories that involved two female protagonists, especially if action were involved. The Dirty Pair story didn't end with the anime, it still continued via movies and OVAs, but I feel like if you really want to know what Dirty Pair is, the anime is required viewing. Some of you might come away with wanting more, but there is no denying that this anime is a good time to be had.